Hello, everyone. This is Rev Paul with Miracles One, and welcome to another episode of Insights on A Course in Miracles. This past week, we've been working on the workbook for students, lessons 24 through 30. So we're going to take a quick look at some of those and some of the highlights, highlighted points around each of those lessons today. So let's go ahead and get started here. In lesson 24, I do not perceive my own best interests. One of the sentences or a couple sentences that actually stood out to me in that particular lesson was, in no situation that arises, do you realize the outcome that would make you happy? Therefore, you have no guide to appropriate action and no way of judging the result. What you do is determined by your perception of the situation, and that perception is wrong. It is inevitable then that you will not serve your own best interests. And right here, this addresses the problem that many of us go through before we start turning and seeking a better way to live our lives, is we get ourselves into these deep spirals into darkness. Depression, you know, poor decisions, poor relationships, problems at our job and our workplace. And it's all because we're following the guide of the ego thought system. We don't realize that there's another guide available to us. And as we go through these lessons, Jesus is going to learn, or is going to help us to learn how to get in touch with that other guide. But in the meantime, all along throughout our lives, we've been just basing all of our decisions based on past experiences and what we think is going to make us happy. And the whole time it's coming from the ego thought system that has absolutely no idea what is really going to make us happy and what are we really after in this life and in the other lifetimes that we've been pursuing. So this is a step to help us to begin to let go of some of that belief system, set it aside for a little bit, for a little while, and allow ourselves an opportunity to begin to open up to something totally new, and that is hidden inside of us, which he starts explaining to us a little bit later here in this group of lessons. In lesson 25, I do not know what anything is for. You perceive the world and everything in it as meaningful in terms of the ego goals. There you go again. These goals have nothing to do with your own best interest because the ego is not you. And that's a little hint, all right? It's not you. And when he says the ego in this example, he's talking about the body, the mind within the body, the brain, and everything that's associated with the body. That is a part of an ego projection and thought system, and we have identified with it. And he's saying, it's not us. It's not really us, and it's blocking, it's giving us these blinders. We think it is us, but it's not really us. And so there's something behind that. There's something underneath it, and he's trying to lead us in a direction where we'll be able to actually discover that and experience it for ourselves. So that's something really to look forward to. In lesson 26, my attack thoughts are attacking my invulnerability. Several sentences stood out to me in this one. Reviewing the unresolved questions whose outcomes are causing you concern. The concern may take the form of depression, worry, anger, a sense of imposition, fear, foreboding, or preoccupation. Any problem as yet unsettled that tends to recur in your thoughts during the day is a suitable subject. And I had a really interesting experience as I was working with this lesson this last week. So it was pretty easy to go into, you know, to go within and practice this lesson and really see that that we all have a lot of thoughts that are fear-based in our normal daily thinking. And each one of those subtle thoughts, if you have If you have a sense of feeling or worry or concern about anything, that is an attack thought, and it's an attack on your invulnerability. The invulnerable part about you is that spiritual being part of you that we're not aware of right now, but we're learning how to become aware of it and getting in touch with it. But every fearful thought that we have, every concern is an attack, and it's putting blinders on. It's holding the blinders on to keep us from experiencing the invulnerable part of ourselves, which is what we really are. It's a facet of what we really are. And the other thing that I noticed is that when I was sleeping that night, I had several dreams, and several of them were just slightly and mildly disturbing. And as I was kind of, you know, half asleep, half awake, and monitoring my dreams, and the thoughts that would come through, I noticed that, wow, the ego thought system is designed to subtly attack us over and over and over and over again, constantly. There's been some studies that, you know, we think approximately 60,000 thoughts a day. And it occurred to me that this process of attack actually continues when we're sleeping and we're dreaming. Because if you pay attention to some of the dreams that you have, you'll notice that for a lot of us, there's angst in there, there's worry in there, we're running from something, trying to get away from something, there's some kind of conflict in some of our dreams. And all of that is fear-based, and each and every one of those is an attack thought. It's an attack on our invulnerability. So I thought that was an interesting perception that kind of came to me as I worked with Holy Spirit on this. And this is a really important concept, because we're learning how to turn around, and we're going to reprogram our brains to think with loving thoughts as we go along, peaceful thoughts as we let go of all this garbage that's in our minds through working through these lessons within the workbook for students. And then in lessons 27, 28, 29, and 30, he makes a shift. So in those first three lessons, you know, he's helping us to realize that we're not following the right guide, and it has been leading us down this painful path for many years. And we really don't understand what it's hiding, and this whole process that's going on and keeping us in this confined space within our minds, kind of keeping us trapped in our minds. And then he shifts in the last four lessons. Above all else, I want to see. Above all else, I want to see things differently. God is in everything I see. God is in everything I see, because God is in my mind. And now this is an exciting shift, because he goes into a little bit more explanation and emphasis about this idea of vision. Keep in mind that when we see through the body's eyes, we are not really experiencing true vision. We're only experiencing a projection of the ego thought system, which manifests this, the illusion of bodies and things all around us. And that is not true seeing at all. In fact, our preoccupation with focusing on all of that stuff is actually blocking our spiritual true seeing or true vision ability. And now Jesus is talking about, hey, let's see, let me find something here for you. So in Above All Else I Want to See, it gives vision priority among your desires, all right? The purpose of today's exercises is to bring the time when the idea will be wholly true a little nearer. And then in lesson 28, Above All Else I Want to See Things Differently, When you have seen one thing differently, you will see all things differently. The light you see in any one of them is the same light you see in them all. And so where he's going with this is we have this dormant spiritual sight that's a very holy sight that's being blocked out by what we're seeing with the body's eyes. And we're learning how to detach from what we think we're seeing with the body's eyes and to kind of shift more toward into our minds where true seeing and spiritual sight starts to kick in right around here. But when your eyes are open, you know, you can learn how to see with the mind instead of with the body's eyes. And I was, when I was kind of talking with Jesus about this, I'm like, what's a way we can kind of try to explain this to help us maybe understand it a little bit better? And he said, think about people who have near-death experiences. When people have a near-death experience, they temporarily leave their body and they go into another dimension, if you will, into the non-physical for a little while. And while they're there, they experience perception of a visual perception, and they also experience a spiritual hearing, and they're not using the body to do that. So what does that mean? It means it's happening at the level of the mind. There's a level of our minds that is beyond the body and beyond the brain. And so because we've temporarily let go of the body, we completely open up to our ability to see with the mind of God, which is inside of us. It's who we are, and it's a part of who we are. And although we kind of, in some of those experiences, we kind of maintain a self-image that we're still a human being in a body or having an out-of-body experience, we're really seeing and hearing with the mind of God inside of us. And then when we come back, somehow we have the memory of that experience, but it didn't manifest from using the body's eyes or the body's ears or the body's touch of feeling or smell, right? So I thought, okay, that's pretty good way of kind of thinking about it. And he's indicating that here within this world, we can learn how to let go enough with our minds of this preoccupation with the physical world around us, and we can allow it to shift through the practice of these lessons and the practice of meditation to allow the spiritual sight to come forth and reveal things to us that are really beyond the physical here. And he indicates that we'll be able to see that. We'll be able to see the light inside of things and behind things and inside of other people and inside of ourselves when we allow that to happen. Now, I've, in my practice over the years, I found it much easier to learn how to do that with my eyes closed, which he indicates in that last lesson that we're actually working with today. He says, practice it. You know, God is in everything I see because God is in my mind. He has us practicing that with our eyes open, but he also suggests with our eyes closed. So while you're practicing this stuff and detaching and just allowing the light to come forth and try to reveal itself to you, if you start to experience flashes of white light, or white light inside of things coming forth, either with your eyes open or closed, you are moving in the right direction. You are learning how to let go with your mind and allow the Holy Spirit to come forth a little bit more and to reveal the light of Christ within you, the light of God within you. And he says that when you see it in one thing, you'll understand it for all things. And that's because the light of God is inside of and behind everything. We're just learning how to allow it to come forward because it's inside of us to project out the experience of perceiving and experiencing God, and it manifests for us to experience. But he says that it's another form of projection. It's a holy form of projection. When we project and see physical things around us with the ego thought system, that is not a holy projection. That's always problematic, right? But now we're going to learn how to project a holy vision for ourselves by allowing it to come forth. So that's the direction we're moving in. And so keep practicing, keep hanging in there, because when that begins to happen, not only will you begin to see the light in other things, you'll at the same time, you'll feel it, the love of God rising up inside of you at the same time. It's a simultaneous experience, and joy and peace and happiness and love starts to kind of fill you up inside while you're experiencing. It's a very holy and joyful experience when it happens. So hang in there, keep practicing. I love you all. Thank you for being my mighty companions, and I'll see you again real soon. Bye-bye.
For more A Course in Miracles video teachings, our study groups, podcasts, self-study courses, articles, and personal A Course in Miracles coaching, access our website at miraclesone.org.